Thank you. Yeah, embracing the weird. First of all, weirdness, we've been talking about it a little bit there too. But for me, weirdness is even more this thing that you don't want to explain. So you put it in a corner, you're not going to look at it. So to me, and for a lot of people, glitches used to be something that I didn't want to have in my life. Something would break and I would just put it there and start over. And it was just something, you know, you're working on a document and you're making, for instance, a very beautiful Photoshop document, and suddenly something goes wrong and it's like, and you're like, oh, I hope I'm gonna get this document back, or is it gonna be broken forever? And you don't want to look, and then hopefully, if you're lucky, either you find out what's happened and it becomes a bug. So it's not the same as a bug, actually. It's what becomes, after you find out what the glitch is, it becomes a bug and you start to debug it. Or it's forever a glitch. You'll never know what it is. So just to put those things like that, benchmarking the deranged. Yeah. CD, no, it's a hard drive. Oh, it's really hurting your eyes? Yeah. Sorry about that. I've never had it in this much light. So it's my first hard drive. It has a lot of memories that I could never resolve anymore. Very beautiful papers that nobody will ever read again, sadly. So just to tell you the story of how I got here, I've been doing a lot of things. I've also studied in Utrecht for 2 weeks. I did the yes, I did the Art Academy. It wasn't for me. One day my art or whatever it was that I made for this thing dropped on the train tracks and I left it there. So that's abandoning Utrecht and coming back here is nice. I like a lot of things. I like to read. I like things that break now because I come to terms with this. And just to tell you this story, but one day I read, for instance, a text by Georges-Louis Borges. I hope I say it right, but I say it completely wrong. It's part of me. It's about this library that has every possible iteration of a book. It's just this huge collection of any kind of amount of letters put together. All the books are there, so it has the most perfect book, and it has the most rotten books, and a lot of garble. So this is like what's my life is like how I find my path is between these lines of garble and what's important. I'm clicking, yes? Okay, cool. It takes a while, it's like this lagging thing. So I like to take these like kind of opposites, new speak versus old speak, Madness versus Sanity by Foucault, Order and Chaos. For me, they are part of the similar thing. They are part of the same side of the coin. I will focus now on Newspeak versus Oldspeak. Clicked. I will just do it like this, the clicking. Yes. Newspeak versus Oldspeak is a very old kind of dichotomy. This is a video about the first Apple Macintosh, which kind of relives this movie that was made about 1984, the book that George Orwell wrote about, Newspeak versus Oldspeak. Newspeak is a language that becomes more and more narrow-minded. All the words that you don't need, you delete. And they were part of the Oldspeak, and Newspeak becomes this like little, very to-the-point vocabulary that you can use. And it's nice, because a while later, after Orwell wrote this book, Apple decided, yes, okay, we want to base our new 1984 Macintosh computer on this. We make this commercial about it, and we'll show that, you know, this female is actually the Apple, that is the lady, kind of signifies the Apple, that will break all this newspeak and will bring like all kinds of new opportunities, yes. Which is great, because actually now when we're using the Apple Macintosh computer, it's not nothing like that. If I use the Apple, it's very limited in the possibilities. So kind of like they were embracing this weirdness in the beginning, in 1984, and they were gonna do some kind of all the opportunities you could ever imagine, which I would like to describe as glitch peak in the way I'm working. But then they kind of start to focus in on everything you want and not everything you could possibly want if you knew it would be possible. So they kind of gave you no opportunity anymore to kind of ask questions. They just show you what you want, and there's no room for questions anymore. So while this whole thing here at TED seems to be about creative solutions, which Apple kind of did. They gave you a creative solution. They gave you this perfect machine. They kind of dismissed this idea for you to make critical or creative problems, which I have to reference John Sedrum, one of my dear friends, who is also a glitch colleague in crime. And together, we make creative problems. And so I think what we really need to learn is how to ask questions again. And glitches, for me, are kind of this benchmark and this threshold to creating new problems and finding new solutions. And this is, I think, really important. One of those things is, for instance, when I have to send my art in to, for instance, a Stedelijk Museum, call something, I don't know. They ask me to send in a JPEG, which is interesting, because I don't know if you're familiar with a JPEG, but a JPEG is a lossy compression, which means that you cut away little bits of information. It's a standardized way of cutting information away, which is standardized by the International Organization of Standardization, IOS. It exists. Big Brother, all that story, Orwell, it already exists before he even wrote about it, the International Organization of Standardization. And they tell you what parts of your artwork are not important. You don't know, as an artist, a lot of people don't realize how important compressions are. And that this is what you're doing all the time as an artist, a digital artist, you're cutting away parts of your art, which is, to me, seems a bit insane. And we don't learn about this language of compressions and how these files are made. So what I did, I was starting to deconstruct these files, and I made a vernacular file formats. And from this, new things have developed, for instance, Extra File by Kim Asendorf. And now you can make your own compressions and decide how to cut away your own information. So just to show you how you can go into a file format, go into how it's being arranged, and then you can edit things. This is me making a weird 3D model through the code instead of on an interface. So, yeah. From that, I made Monglot together with Johan Larsby, who is a programmer from Sweden. Monglot gives you the opportunity to transcode from one file format to another, put some errors, and kind of learn how these languages come together. So the language of the backend of the file format and language of the image and how it looks, they kind of clash together, and you can learn from it. If you're not familiar with file formats, this kind of shows you how this is all created. Faster. No, I'm there almost. Okay. This is one of my, this all is very great if you're an artist and all that, but it's not a real situation because there's only so many artists, and it's not, artists have their own problems, and it's great for them. But in reality, everybody is using Facebook, or half of everybody these days. And there is some real issues there, because Facebook also makes you answer to particular formats and particular languages. This is an artwork by a glitcher, Laimonos Sakas from Lithuania. And he made this page called Glitcher, and he would write in this diacritic style, which is what you see, all this garble there. There, that one. Yeah, this. And Facebook didn't like that. He had a lot of followers. At some point, he had 15K followers, so 15,000 followers. And Facebook decided, we don't like this kind of language. It's not part of our protocols. We'll delete it. And his page was deleted. He was very sad because he put a lot of time in it. And he started to Google who had liked his page in the past, and he found 12 people that were actually working for Facebook. So he started to send them messages asking, why did you delete this? Finally, he got an answer. It's because of the language you're using. He said, if I change the language a bit, will you get it back? He got it back, and they actually offered him to start debugging Facebook with them. So he got actually also offered kind of a, not like a job, but he got an in to make some money from his work as a glitcher to make Facebook better. So glitches are very important to research, but you have to learn how to research them. So our very beautiful friend, Kanye West, was a rapper from America. He is also a glitch artist. You didn't know that, probably, but this is a still from his video, Welcome to Heartbreak, in which he sings about his sad love stories. We're happy that it's better now. And in that story, he uses glitches to show his heartbreak. But what shows is that every glitch will become something standardized and popularized, or it's put away. But there's either two ways to go. So with that, I just want to kind of end this. Thank you very much.